Hello everyone, I am Santosh KG, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, MIT, Mysore. Today, we are going to discuss the unit Governors, which comes under Module 3 of subject Dynamics of Machines. In today's class, we will be learning the following concepts regarding the governor. The first concept will be definition, followed by types of governors, followed by principle of working of a centrifugal governor. Then we are going to derive the expression for the equilibrium speed of a Porter governor, followed by we will solve some problems. So first let us see what is a definition of a governor. A governor, it is a mechanical device which is used to regulate the mean speed of an engine within the specified limit under varying load condition. I repeat, it is a mechanical device which is used to regulate the mean speed of an engine in the specified limit when the load is varying. That is, when the load on the engine it decreases, we know that its speed is going to increase. Similarly, when load increases, its speed is going to decrease. It means that under the variation of a load, there will be a variation of speed. Suppose even though the load is varying, if you want to maintain the speed of an engine within the specified limit, then we can make use of a device which is called a governor. Next, we will try to see what are the different types of governors. Now, we will see the types of governors. So, based on the principle of working, the governors are mainly classified into two types. One is called as an inertia governor, and the second one is called as a centrifugal governor. We already know that a governor is used to regulate the speed. So if the governor regulates the speed by making use of the inertia forces, then the governor is called as an inertia governor. And in order to regulate the speed, if it makes use of a centrifugal force, then it is called as a centrifugal governor. The centrifugal governor further classified into two types. One is a pendulum type governor and another one is a loaded type governor. It is based on what is the additional weight we are going to place on the sleeve. So if you don't put any weight on the sleeve, then the centrifugal governor will be called as a pendulum type governor. Suppose if you place some amount of weight on the governor, then it will be called as a loaded type governor. And based upon the type of load we are going to place on a governor, the loaded governor, further it will be classified into two types. One is called as a deadweight governor and the second one is called as a spring-loaded governor. Suppose on the sleeve, if you are going to place some additional weight, then the type of governor, it is called as a deadweight loaded type centrifugal governor. Suppose if the sleeve is loaded by using a spring, then the type of governor is called as a spring-loaded type centrifugal governor. So one of the example for deadweight governor is a Porter governor, and one of the example for a spring-loaded governor, it is an Hartnell governor, and one of the example for a pendulum type governor is a Watt governor. In our syllabus, we will be having the Porter governor and Hartnell governor, and we are going to study these two in details. But before studying the Porter governor and Hartnell governor in detail, since they are coming under the loaded type centrifugal governor, first let us try to see how the centrifugal governors are going to work. So this can be understood by learning the principle of the centrifugal governor. Now, coming to the working principle of simple centrifugal governor. So the working of the simple centrifugal governor can be understood with the help of this diagram. This diagram represents the schematic representation of a simple centrifugal governor. Now let us try to see what are the different parts a simple governor is having. So the simple centrifugal governor consisting of a spindle on which we are having a sleeve. So this sleeve can be made to slide up and down on this spindle. The upward movement of this sleeve can be limited by making use of the stopper S1, and the downward movement of this sleeve can be limited by making use of the stopper S2. This spindle is connected to the engine shaft with the help of the bevel gears. Then the two balls, which are called as the governor balls, they are connected to the spindle with the help of the upper arms, and then the governor balls are connected to the sleeve with the help of the lower arms. Since the spindle is connected to the engine shaft with the help of the bevel gears, so when the engine shaft rotates at higher speed, the spindle is also going to rotate at higher speed, and when the engine shaft rotates at lower speed, the spindle is also going to rotate at the lower speed. Now, let us see how it is going to work. Let us say the given governor is working at the design speed, and the load on the governor at a given instant, it is going to decrease. So when the load on the governor, on the shaft, it is decreases, then the speed of the engine is going to increase. So when the speed of the engine increases, the spindle, it starts to rotate at higher speed. So when the spindle rotates at higher speed, the balls which are connected to the spindle with the help of upper arm, they are also going to rotate with the higher speed. So when they rotate with the higher speed, it generates the centrifugal force which are going to pull the balls in outward direction. So when the ball is pulled in the outer direction, the lower arms, they are going to pull the sleeve in upward direction. So this can be explained like this. So when the load on the engine, it comes down, the speed of the engine shaft, it is going to increase. So when the speed increases, the centrifugal force, it is going to increase. So when the centrifugal force increases, the sleeve will move in the upward direction from the mean position. Next, suppose if the load that is acting on an engine, it is going to reduce. So when, increase. So when the load on the engine increases, the engine shaft, it is going to rotate at the lesser speed. So when the engine shaft rotates at the lesser speed, the spindle is also going to rotate at the lesser speed. So when the spindle rotates at lesser speed, these two balls, they are going to rotate at very lesser speed. So when they are rotating at the lesser speed, the amount of centrifugal force generated, it is going to decrease. So when the centrifugal force generated is going to reduce, the balls are pulled towards the spindle. So when these two balls are pulled towards the spindle, these two lower links, which is connected to the sleeve, they are going to push the sleeve in downward direction. So this can be summarized like this. When the load that is acting on the engine, when it increases, the speed of the engine shaft, it is going to decrease. When the speed decreases, the centrifugal force, it is also going to decrease. So when the centrifugal force decreases, the sleeve is going to move in the downward direction. So we can relate the speed of the engine with respect to the movement of the sleeve like this. So when the speed of the engine increases, the sleeve is going to move in the upward direction, and when the speed of the engine decreases, the sleeve is going to move in the downward direction. Now, this sleeve is connected to the throttle valve with the help of a bell crank lever in such a way that whenever the sleeve, it moves in upward direction, it will reduce the amount of fuel which is entering into the engine. So when the fuel entering into the engine is reduced, it will reduce the speed to the required speed. Similarly, when the sleeve is moving in the downward direction, the throttle valve is going to increase the amount of fuel that is entering into the engine. So when the more amount of fuel enter into the engine, then the amount of power generated will increase the speed, and thereby it brings the speed to the required level. Thus, the simple centrifugal governor, they will be making use of the centrifugal force in order to maintain the speed by controlling the amount of fuel which is entering into the engine. So this represents how the simple centrifugal governor works by making use of the centrifugal force. After learning the principle of centrifugal governor, now let us come to a Porter governor. Now let us see how it is going to differ from a simple centrifugal governor. So in a simple centrifugal governor, we will be having a spindle. On the spindle, we will be having a sleeve, and we will be having two governor balls, and these two governor balls are connected to the spindle with the help of the upper arms, and then these two balls are connected to the sleeve with the help of lower arms. So this is the diagram of a simple centrifugal governor. On the simple centrifugal governor, if I place some additional weight on the sleeve, then it is known as a Porter governor. Since we are adding some dead weight on the sleeve, the Porter governor is called as a dead weight loaded centrifugal governor. Next, after learning what is the Porter governor, now we are going to derive the expression for equilibrium speed of a Porter governor. So far, we have discussed definition, types of governors, working of a simple centrifugal governor, followed by a definition of a Porter governor. A Porter governor will be similar to that of a centrifugal governor. Only thing is, on the sleeve, we will be having some dead weight is placed over the sleeve. Now, let us try to derive the expression for equilibrium speed of the Porter governor. So this is the schematic representation of a Porter governor. It consisting of two upper arms connected to the spindle axis and two lower arm connected to the sleeve and the balls. Let us consider that the mass of each ball is small m, and the weight which is placed on the sleeve is having mass capital M. Now, if I draw an axis passing through the center of the Porter governor, we can observe that the portion of the Porter governor to the left of the axis is similar to the portion of the Porter governor towards the right of the axis. It means that the Porter governor is symmetrical about the vertical axis. So whenever a given object or a device is symmetrical about certain axis, so to do any analysis, if you consider half of the portion, it is enough. Thus, in order to derive the expression for the equilibrium speed of a Porter governor, we will be considering only half of the Porter governor. That is, we have considered one upper arm followed by one lower arm. Then at the intersection of this upper arm and the lower arm, we are having the ball, governor ball, which is connected at point A, and the lower arm is connected to the sleeve at point B. So I have taken only half of the Porter governor. Here, let us say that this upper arm with respect to the spindle axis, it is making an angle theta. Similarly, the lower arm with respect to the spindle axis, let us say it is making an angle beta. Then what I will do is, from the upper arm, I am going to draw a line, or I will extend a line from the upper arm, and from point B, where the sleeve is connected to the lower arm, there I am going to draw one perpendicular. So the point where the line drawn from the upper axis, the upper arm, and the perpendicular drawn from point B, they are going to intersect, that point we are going to call it as I, which is one of the instantaneous center of rotation of this Porter governor. So I represents the instantaneous center of rotation for the given mechanism. So far we have seen that the theta, it represents the angle of intersection of the upper arm with respect to the spindle axis, and beta, it represents the angle of made by the lower arm with respect to the spindle axis. Then the point I represents the instantaneous center of rotation, one of the instantaneous center of rotation for the given mechanism. And other than that, we will be defining two more terms, which is called as H and R, where H is called as the height of governor, and it represents the vertical distance. It represents the vertical distance from the center of the ball to the point where the upper arm is connected to the spindle axis. So from the vertical distance from the center of the ball to the point where the upper axis is connected to the spindle axis, this vertical distance we are taking it as H. Similarly, here we are defining one more term, which is called as R, and it represents radius of the governor. So the radius of governor is nothing but it represents the horizontal distance, between the center of the ball to the axis of the spindle. So now, so far we have defined what is theta, what is beta, and what is R, followed by what is H. Since we need to derive the expression for the equilibrium speed, we will consider the equilibrium condition. So the mathematically, the equilibrium condition can be written like this. The summation of the horizontal, the summation of all the forces, it should be zero. And the second equilibrium condition will be the summation of moments should be equals to zero. So if you want to keep the member under equilibrium, these two conditions should be satisfied. So first, what I am going to do is I will show what are the various forces that will be acting in case of a governor. So in case of a Porter governor, the various forces we are going to get are, the first one is the force due to the mass of the ball. So the mass of the ball is expressed in terms of kg. So to the mass of the ball, if you multiply g, which is acceleration due to gravity, then it represents the force due to the mass of the ball, which is mg, and it will be acting in downward direction from point A. So here, from point A, you have written the force mg, which is acting in the downward direction. Similarly, we have placed some amount of weight, capital M, on the sleeve. So capital M represents the mass of the sleeve in kgs. So for the mass of the sleeve, if you multiply g, which is acceleration due to gravity, we will get the force which is produced due to the sleeve, and it will be in terms of Newton. So mg will be the force that will be produced due to the sleeve, and this mg, it will be shared by two lower arms. But while doing the analysis, since we are considering only half of the portion, so we should consider only the weight carried by one of the lower arm. So if the two arms, they are carrying the total load mg, then one arm will be carrying the load mg by 2 at point B. So we have shown the force mg by 2 at point B. Similarly, when the sleeve is moving on the spindle, due to the contact, we will get a force which is called as a frictional force, and it is denoted by F. So the frictional force direction will be always opposite, to the movement of the sleeve. The sleeve, it can move either in upward direction or in downward direction. So when the sleeve is moving in upward direction, the frictional force will be acting in downward direction. Similarly, when the sleeve is moving in the downward direction, the frictional force, it will be acting in upward direction. Since the frictional force, it will be acting in both the direction, depending upon the movement of the sleeve, we will write the frictional force with plus or minus sign, which will take care the direction of movement of the frictional force. Hence, at point B, we are going to get the force mg plus or minus F by 2. So far we have considered two forces. One is small mg, which will be due to the mass of the governor ball, and the second force is mg plus or minus f by 2, and it is because of the sleeve. And when the spindle rotates, we will see that the governor ball is also going to rotate in a circle which is having radius r. So because of the rotation of this ball, we will get an outward force which is called as a centrifugal force. So Fc represents the centrifugal force, and it can be calculated by using the formula m omega square r, where m represents mass of the ball and r represents the radius of rotation of the ball, which we are denoting by r, and omega represents the speed with which the ball is going to rotate. So if you consider a centrifugal governor, we will be having only three forces. One is Fc, and the second one is small mg, and the next one is mg plus or minus f by 2. These are the three forces we are going to get in case of a centrifugal governor when it is operating with certain speed. Now, as I told that for equilibrium, the summation of the forces should be equal to 0, and also the summation of moments at certain point, it should be equal to 0. In order to derive the expression for the equilibrium speed, we shall consider the equilibrium condition sigma m equals to 0. Let us take the moment about point I, so that the summation of moments about point I, it should be 0. So the moments, if you take the moments in nature, particularly it will be either in clockwise in nature or it will be in counterclockwise in nature. So the counterclockwise moment, if the force is creating a counterclockwise moment, then let us take it as positive. And if the force, if it happens to create a clockwise moment, let us consider that moment with a negative sign. So with in front of the moment, if I write the positive sign, it represents that the moment will be acting in counterclockwise direction. And if I write negative sign in front of the moment, then it represents a clockwise moment. So in Porter governor, we have seen that only three forces are acting. One is Fc, another one is small mg, another one is capital Mg plus or minus f by 2. So these three forces are at distance A, B, C respectively from point I. Now let us try to take moment about point I. So if I try to take moment about point I, so this force Fc, it is going to create a counterclockwise couple. So the force Fc into perpendicular distance A, it is going to create a counterclockwise moment. So I have written Fc into A. Since it is creating a counterclockwise couple, I am writing positive sign in front of it. Then we consider the force Mg. So this force Mg with respect to point I, it is going to create a clockwise moment. So the amount of moment created is Mg multiplied by B. So this is the moment, and it is going to rotate in clockwise direction. So since the moment is in clockwise, we are going to denote it with a negative sign. Then the another force we are having is Mg plus or minus f by 2, and it is at a distance of B plus C from point I, and it is going to rotate in clockwise direction. So the moment Mg plus or minus f by 2 is at a perpendicular distance of B plus C from point I, and it is going to create a clockwise moment. Since it is going to create a clockwise moment, we are going to denote it with a negative sign. So when you add all the three moments, the summation should be equals to 0. Now what I am going to do is, I am going to substitute in place of Fc, I am going to substitute m omega square r, and I am going to send all the negative moments towards the right side of the equality sign. So if I do so, in place of MC, FC, I have written M omega square R A, I have written as it is, and I have sent these two terms to the right side of this equality sign. As a result, those two will become positive. So the equation I'm going to get after this process is M omega square R into A will be equals to Mg into B plus Mg plus R minus F by 2 into B plus C. Now I'm going to simplify it further by sending A to the right side. So since if I send A to the right side, it will go to the denominator. Since at the left right side we are having two terms, at the right side since we are having two terms, if I divide them with a single term, then it will be like this, x by a plus y by a. So as a result, if I send a to the right side, so the above equation will be altered like this. Mg I will be retaining as it is. If I send a towards right side, it will come to the denominator, so b by a plus Mg plus or minus F by 2, here we are having B plus C. If I divide it by A, I can write it as C by A plus B by A. Now, if I use this triangle A, D and B, so by using this triangle, I can relate C and A by using beta. So the C and A, these two terms are, can be replaced by tan beta, and if you use the triangle AID, then the term AB by A, it can be replaced by tan theta. So by using these two triangles, we have replaced C by A by tan beta and B by A by tan theta. So in place of B by A, write tan theta, B by A tan theta, and in place of C by A, we have replaced it by tan beta. Now, if you look at these two terms, here we are having tan theta common, so I will take it outside. So if I take tan theta as a common in these two terms, then the equation will become like this. So tan theta, I have taken it common. So in first term, we'll be left with Mg, and in second term, if I take tan theta outside, Mg plus or minus F by 2, it will remain as it is. So tan theta, I have taken it outside, so it will be 1 plus tan beta by tan theta. So this tan beta by tan theta, I am going to write it as K. So K represents, it is the ratio of tan beta by tan theta. Now we are having the equation on the left side, we are having M omega square R. On the right side, we will be having the equation tan theta in bracket Mg plus capital Mg plus or minus F by 2 into 1 plus K, where K represents the ratio of tan beta by tan theta. Similarly, if I consider this triangle O, A, G, from this triangle R and H and theta, R, H and theta, it can be related by a trigonometric function tan theta will be equals to R by H. So using the triangle OAG, we can write tan theta as R by H. So I'm going to write in place of tan theta R by H. The remaining thing will be same, small mg plus capital Mg plus or minus F by 2 into 1 plus K. So on the left hand side we are having R, on the right hand side also we are having R. So I'm going to cancel these two R, and I'm going to send this M towards the right side. So when I send M towards the right side, it will come to the denominator, and on the left side we'll be left with the omega square. So the equation will be omega square will be equals to 1 by MH, and I will take LCM. So in the denominator we are having 2. And if I take the LCM, the above equation will be like this, 2mg plus capital Mg plus or minus F into 1 plus K divided by 2. So here omega represents angular speed in radians per second, which is an expression for equilibrium speed.